Hello. On behalf of Amazing Grace Lutheran Church, located in Lawrenceville, Georgia, I'm Pastor Mary Armstrong Reiner, the interim pastor here. As you listen to the sermon today, may you know that God's grace and love surround you in whatever you may be facing. And have a blessed day.
Leave sad. And I find it interesting because I guess if I might have been the young rich ruler, I might have stuck around to see if I could bargain with Jesus. You know, you sure got to give everything away? You sure I can't keep a few things? Can't I just go on the road with you on the weekends when I'm not working? I mean, you know, bargain, but he doesn't do that. And I find that interesting. He just accepts, and it says he leaves sad. It would make me sad too. Because obviously he had a sense of who Jesus was, and he really did want to follow him. And it's interesting because we hear that Jesus looked at him with love. Because Jesus probably already knew the answer before he gave one. We may not be as rich as the rich young ruler, but in the world today, we are all rich people. And not just with family and friends and faith, but with monetary wealth. And you may say, but Pastor, I can't pay my bills, and I understand that. But you know, if we look and pay attention, the reality of the world is we are wealthy. We have more than enough. Now, some of you may be hurting, because that's part of life, and some of you may be struggling. But in the reality of the world, we are wealthy. And this gospel is speaking to all of us, right where we live, right where we are today. The scripture talks about it would be easier for the camel to pass through the eye of the needle. Art, can you start the... So harvest time, the rich young man. And I like this illustration. See the needle and the camel? I think Jesus says this to really drive home the point and to make us think about what he's saying. I don't know how many of you have ever threaded a needle, but recently I had to thread one for my son's Boy Scout uniform to put his patches on. And as I've gotten older, I need a bright light and as strong a glasses as possible.
Amen.
And maybe I'll get the thread and the needle and maybe I won't. Somehow it happened. It was God that made it happen. I'm not kidding. And you know, they sell that little thing to try to get it in, but I can't work that either. And so I was reminded that as hard as it is to get thread, which should fit through a needle to go, it's difficult to go through. How much more preposterous is it to think about a camel going through the eye of a needle? But Jesus wants us to pay attention, I believe, when he says that. He wants us to think about this. He wants us to realize that if it's our doing, it is impossible. And on this week on Facebook, a number of clergy were talking about the supposed archaeological find of a gate that was called the Eye of the Needle. But most of them said that it's been refuted and it's not really real. I'm still not completely sure whether there was such a thing in that time or not. But I think the point for us today is to look at this and to realize that what Jesus is asking is impossible in the eyes of the world and in the eyes of most of our lives. But it hit me as I was talking to Leah this morning that in 1993, a few weeks after my husband David and I married, my parents, who lived in this house all of the 35 years then of marriage, the house was destroyed by the Mississippi flood because we lived a quarter of a mile from the Mississippi River. And the river broke after a month of fighting it. My parents, we had moved twice when I was a child and were never flooded. And I think my parents thought we would make it a third time. But instead, the river rose to knee high on the second floor of our home. Stayed there for over 3 weeks, and my parents lost almost every possession they had ever owned in their 35 years of marriage. But everyone in our community survived. And in that experience, I realized how clearly that what we have is not what's most important.
Amen.
That we can lose it all in a fire, or in a bankruptcy, or in a loss of a job, or a divorce. That all of our earthly goods can be gone. And yet what still remains is our faith and our family and our friends. and you can't buy those. You may try, but they won't be sticking around when the money's gone. Because faith is a gift we cannot purchase. It is a gift. Jesus says, it is impossible for human beings, but all things are possible with God. Next one. So stuff. Think about all the stuff you and I have. Think about the stuff for every holiday, for all those boxes maybe you haven't been through for a few years, for all those clothes in your closet, for all that stuff you've been meaning to get rid of, give it away or recycle it. Last year when David and I moved, we had lived in the house we did for 10 years, and for some of you that's just a very short period of time, but ever since I went to college, that's the longest I've lived anywhere. And we were not going to move everything. I will confess, we moved 16,000 pounds of books, which is amazing. Yeah, that's what they figured them out to be. But you have to remember, my husband got a PhD, and we both went to seminary, and we both love books. But I don't need that many books, and I haven't even opened half the boxes, and I realize I could give most of it away, and it wouldn't hurt me or bother me, because I'd always find a way, if I really wanted to read it again, to get it. I remember when we were in college, our priest at the Newman Center said to us once, while you're in college, you probably have the least amount of stuff you will ever have in your life. And it was true. I had a box of records and some clothes. There was no computers in those days that anybody owned, so nobody had a phone. And I had a few orange crates or milk crates. You remember those. You put your stuff in them in your room. But when you left college, you could, maybe it was bulging a little bit, but you could get most everything in your big old car as you move to your first job or to the next place you were going to go. And he said, there's a blessing in that. There's a blessing in having so little. And I think about that when I go to the nursing home. And I think about people's lives that have been filled with the home of children and grandchildren and all the things they needed. And that when they come to the nursing home, it comes down to a tiny little space with a few pictures of their loved ones and maybe a little trinket or two from their life. And what I realize is life is not about stuff. It is for our kids on Christmas, but the older I get, the more I realize that what matters the most to me is my faith and the time I have with my family and my friends, and that it can all go away once again. And I might be sad for a moment, but it wouldn't last long. Because really what Jesus is trying to say is it's not about stuff. It's about relationship with God. And that anything, whether it be money or stuff or our hobbies or our job, you name it, anything that we put in front of God in our lives, it needs to go. Because what is most important in our lives is our relationship with Jesus. What is most important is our relationship with each other. What is most important is the community of believers that we are blessed to be a part of, that we see each other through the good and the bad times, that we pray for each other and we rely upon each other and we help each other. And yes, occasionally we may give each other stuff that we really need, like food when we're sick or ill, or flowers or a visit, or words of care or a hug. But stuff, does it really matter? In the end, no. So whatever dream you may be chasing, I hope it's bigger than stuff. I hope it's a dream God has put in your heart of what the world, God has called you into. Because this is today, and we are here to thank God for the lives we have been blessed with, for this church that is the community that God has called us into. And as part of our blessing and as part of our gratefulness, we say thank you. It's not my job to tell you what to give or how to give, but just to remind each and every one of us that we are called to be thankful with our lives. And if you want to know where you really spend your time, all you have to do, okay, I know nobody keeps a checkbook register anymore, so pull up your online bank statement or on your phone, and besides paying your bills, because everyone who gets over 20 years old, let's just say, knows that you got to pay bills, you got to pay rent or your mortgage, you got to pay your electricity, your utilities, you got to buy food, you got to have a way to get to a job or to school. So the reality is yes, we have to have money, and if you look at what you pay, you'll know where your money goes. But then beyond that, beyond those bills, if you look at how you spend your money, if you look at how you spend your time beyond your job, beyond your family, how do you spend your time? Where do you give your energy? If you look at how you use the talents God has given you, where are you giving them? Where are you sharing them in the church and in the world? This is what speaks to you of what matters most to you. And as you can see, your time and our talents and our treasures. And so I just want to remind you of a couple of things this morning. That the church would not be the church without each and every one of you. Even though we are sinful and broken people, God uses the good of us for the good of His community here in this place, in this church, in our community, and in the world. And there is simply not enough hours or energy or time for myself and the staff to do everything. It takes every one of us to be part of this church, to make it what God has called it to be. It takes everyone's gifts and talents and passions and energies. From the Wednesday homework cup, which by the way, we need some help with the neighborhood kids. So if you've got an hour once a month, come and join us on Wednesday night to help the kids. And you don't have to be a math genius. We've already got Perry for that, so we don't have to worry about that. But you could read a book with a kid. You can be a part of their lives. Come and join us, because we can't do it all. But from Wednesday night homework help to food for the Lawrenceville Co-op, to the grace bags, from the people who go out and purchase it and put it together so that Dave Linky can stand out here and talk it to us and remind us, when you see a homeless person, give them this bag. We couldn't do it without you. And now the grace kits for children at church schools, to know that this church cares about their personal needs. All of you make what this church does possible. There would be no programs, no things really happening in our community if it wasn't for you and for everyone joining together. We wouldn't have Arts and Crafts Fair that has touched people, not just to come and buy stuff, but also to be in community and to see this church in action and see the money that comes out of that to bless different ministries. And I'm not picking on anyone, but I have to say, if you think about your gifts and your talents, and forgive me, but I got permission from your daughter, Char. From the moment I came here and I met Char Rinke, she makes everyone feel welcome and recognized because she is the greeter extraordinaire. And if we didn't have that, all of you, I won't name you by name, but I thank you, because if you didn't usher, if you didn't do the altar guild, if you didn't sing in the choir, if you didn't bring the readings or do the children's talks, if you didn't help with Sunday school, if you didn't do what you do, if you didn't serve on council, I point out Bob Lee, he said he's been treasurer for 12 years. We owe that man a debt of gratitude. This church would not be what it is if not for you being moved by God, loving you, and giving up your time and your talents and your energy. And where this church will go in the future will not just depend on who the new pastor is, but on all working together with the pastor and the staff, bringing your energy and your time and your commitment of your funds for God to do the work God is doing in this place and will continue to do into the future. So I am thankful. And I ask us all to think today, what is it we are thankful for? I'm thankful for each and every one of you, named and unnamed. For those of you who would rather hide behind the scenes, we still know what you do and we're grateful. And God sees and God knows. Because all of us in this church, Amazing Grace, are called to use our time and our talents and our treasures. Because in the end, God loves you. And even though life seems impossible, and even though what we're struggling each one of us with may be difficult, God is with you in the midst of whatever you are dealing with, helping you through and seeing you through whatever might be on your heart today. For it is grace. It is grace. God's unearned gift to us that we do not merit or deserve, but is given to us through Jesus Christ. That we can have the ability to face that which seems impossible to face. That we can have courage and joy as we look into what the future might bring. That we have hope that God is doing bigger and greater things than we can even begin to imagine in the small ways God is calling us to serve Him through this church, our community, and the world. So no easy answers. Jesus wants us to wrestle with how we do money. He wants us, I think, to see it as a tool, as a gift, that not only provide for ourselves and our family, but also as a way to serve Him. And in the end, it's not about the stuff. It's not about the money. It's about our gratefulness and our thankfulness for what God has blessed us with and what we want to do to say thank you. Thank you, God, for blessing me with my faith, for my family, for my life. We come this day with open hearts. We come in gratefulness and thankfulness to live a grace-filled and loving life that has been bestowed upon us by the one who gave everything for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.